So, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, let's hear it. Okay. Eins, zwei, drei, eins, zwei, drei. Und jetzt mit Musik.
We're still goodbye. And as long as you love me so.
Gut, Musik und Mikrofon läuft. Gut. So, Mario, wahrscheinlich bist du der Einzige, der heute kommt. So, please say hello in the chat. So I know you are here. Hope it all works. So, microphone was off, now the microphone is working. Kein Ton, I know. Okay, starting in about 7 minutes. So let's see what Google is saying or YouTube is saying about the stream. Okay. The quality. Okay. Stream is okay, latency of the Cubase is okay. So we have a latency of about 10 seconds between what I say here and when it's arriving on your computer. So please be patient when you write something in the chat. It can take 10 to 20 seconds until I respond to that. So hello everybody. And let's wait some more minutes and then we're going to start with Let It Snow, another production in Cubase. Cubase only and no third party plugins. So let's save that for a moment. I'm not losing that. Oh, let's check it here. Okay. this one. So it's prepared for you. This. Okay. And let me bring the MIDI editor on the side here. This computer and this. Okay. That should be it. MIDI, audio, and everything. Okay, let's wait another 5 minutes. Hello from Serbia. Sarko Jankovic. Hello to Serbia. Nice to meet you. Nice that you are here in my live stream. This is the last live stream and the last video for this year, for that infamous 2020 year. Let's hope 2021 is better than this year. It's going to be better. So Sarko, for you, if you have any questions, put it in the chat. If you have any recommendations for a video or a live stream, put it in the comments later or in the chat. I'm glad if I can help, and I'm always happy if someone is asking for something or for a kind of music I'm going to produce. And I'm happy to do that for you. And like always, everything Cubase, just to show you what you can do in Cubase. And no third-party plugins. I'm going to make another YouTube channel under my full name, Harald Metzner, which is going to be mostly about third-party plugins, but this channel will be strictly Cubase. So, I hope you can all read the text here, what's going on today. I released that video sometimes ago and on the Christmas day, so I'm going to talk a little bit about the arrangement I made, about what I made in Cubase, also about how it is to working with a deadline. And most of all today, it will be about vocal recording, but not so much about the microphone, amplifier, effects or whatever, more about singing, what you have to take care of, and why you should record your own voice in the first place. Okay. So, and if any of you has some special wishes, like last time somebody asked me for that, well, the Cubase arrangement, I think it was the trap beat or what it was, and he didn't have the Cubase Pro version, only the artist version. I'm happy to know what version you have, so I can take care about that, and that I can, for example, make a template or make a version of a song that you can download from me that is also running with all the effects in Cubase Artists or also Elements. Okay, 2 minutes to go, and I don't want to start early, because I know that in the last minute, some more people will gather, so wait for a moment, everything prepared here, go here, you already see in the top right window my Cubase. And the full arrangement, this is about 40 tracks that I have here. And I will go mainly through the arrangement, what I did, how I arranged everything, especially what I did with the horn parts and brass, and what I did with the lead sheet, what the lead sheet is, and how you can work with it, with the chord track. So you can see what Cubase can do for you in terms of writing songs or also in terms of producing songs, not only your original music. So if you want to make a cover, you can do that fast and easy. Okay, an unusual day. Normally I'm doing this on the weekend, but I wanted to do that before the new year starts, so I'm doing this on the week today, on Wednesday. And, good. So starting in some seconds, the countdown is up. Okay, let's start. Let's turn off the countdown timer and let's go over to my Cubase arrangement screen. Hello, everybody. Let's go back for a moment. Today, I'm going to talk about the arrangement I made for the song Let It Snow, which is a famous Christmas carol. Was written about 1920 something. And there are very famous versions out there of this song. For example, one is very famous by Frank Sinatra. And I'm going to talk about the arrangement, about how I set everything up in terms of the chord track, in terms of my instruments I used, and I will mainly focus in the second half of this live stream about recording my vocals. And this is my voice. This is me singing. And I'm going to talk about why you should record your own vocals, your own singing, and why it's fun, and what Cubase can do for you, and how you can get used to your own voice. But before that, maybe you haven't seen my video on the channel. I'm going to play that song for a moment. I'm going to turn off my microphone and play the song. And I'm back in about 2 minutes, and I think it's 10 seconds.
Oh, the weather outside is frightful, but the fire is so delightful. And since we've no place to go, let it snow, let it snow, let it snow. It doesn't show signs of stopping, and I bought some corn for popping. The lights are turned way down low. Let it snow, let it snow, let it snow. When we finally kiss goodnight, how I hate going out in the storm. But if you really hold me tight, all the way home I'll be warm. Oh, the fire is slowly dying, and my dear, we're still goodbying. And as long as you love me so, let it snow, let it snow, let it snow. When we finally kiss goodnight, how I hate going out in the storm. But if you really hold me tight, all the way home I'll be warm. Oh, the fire is slowly dying, and my dear, we're still goodbying. And as long as you love me so, let it snow, let it snow, let it snow. Let it snow, let it snow, let it snow. Let it snow, let it snow, let it snow.
So that's it. The song is Let It Snow. It's a famous song from the 20s, 30s, 40s, last century. And a famous version out there from Frank Sinatra. And maybe some of you noticed I have some, let's say, artificial vocals down here. I have my vocals and I have generated some of the vocals with the harmonizer function, in Cubase, generate harmonies. And because I was playing around with the arrangement for some time before I started to scream, it was too loud. Maybe you noticed that, but let's just go through the arrangement and let's look on how I address the song to make the song working. Okay, let's turn off that lower third for a moment here so that you can see everything. So the first thing I was starting with was I got a version from, I think it was a singer. I don't remember the name, from Spotify, and listened to some versions of the song. Some were more with piano, and some were with horns and brass like that, with a big band sound. And so I thought about going for this sound, making it like a big band sound. I had a deadline. I wanted to release it with a video I released on Christmas evening, the 25th. In Germany, we celebrate the 24th. I know in the US, they are celebrating Christmas Eve. I think it's the 25th. And so I had only 5 or 6 days working, maybe 1 hour a day, at the most, sometimes only 30 minutes on the song. So the whole arrangement, everything with singing, with arranging, starting from scratch, took me about 6 to 7 hours complete to make this. So what did I start with? I started with a lead sheet I found on the internet, which looks like this. A lead sheet is only the harmonies, meaning this is only the melody plus the chords plus the text in an easy to read, sheet music. So it's not written out everything, and it's not everything arranged. So you only have the chords, you have the melody, and you have the vocals, so the text. So this is it. And I had some problems with this because the chords were not right. I see from the notes that this is in C major, but the chords didn't mean any minor chord here. So there was also like a D or an A here, and a big A and a big D means major chord, and small letters means minor chord, or you have a big uppercase D with a min, M-I-N behind it, that it means minor. But I did it then in C major, the whole thing. So what I did first was I went to my Cubase and put up a chord track. You can split your track lanes in Cubase. You can see up here. You can split it here. So you can zoom individually and make your tracks up there. This is this little divide track list, this little sign here. If you click on that, you have the second track list up here, and you can track from here, from your main list, over your tracks up here to the upper list, and this will stay all the time like this. So these are my main tracks I have here. The first is the chord track, and the chords you see right now are not the chords you hear in the arrangement, because I had to lower it by one semitone so I was able to sing it. So I used all the chords from the lead sheet, and in the same arrangement I did then my marker track here. I used the cycle markers to sketch out the arrangement of the song. So it's starting with the intro, then we have two verses here, then we have what I call the middle eight, that's that middle part, it's in minor, then we have a verse again, then we have the solo, which is from the verse or from the main part, the same harmonies, then the middle eight is coming again, we have another verse, and we have the ending. So when I start with that, and I do that on all the arrangement, I start with chords. When I start with that, the first thing I do is I put up a piano track, which is here, my piano track, which is here. And then I just mark all my chords and drag them down to this track so that, and now I shifted around, but it doesn't matter. So that I have the track here and have the chords here. So when I play it in solo, I have all the chords playing. Let's see if this follows. Let's go to this start here. Okay, we cannot hear that. Let's see what we have here. Why isn't that playing? Because it's not muted. Let's check this. Go here. And normally I have the piano here. No, it's not rooted. It's not rooted to the proper output, maybe. Let's see here, stereo out, and then we go to the mix bus. Like this, and it's turned off here. So let's play this. Okay. And the mix bus. Okay, let me go back. Back to that. And here, and solo this. So I'm always starting with having the chords here on the top, and then I have the melody, which is the next one, and I have the melody and the chords set up from the lead sheet I showed you, so that I have everything, my melody, my chords. And what I started then with the next part was my drums. And this is a swing like Benny Goodman or Glenn Miller you have from the 40s, from the 50s. So I started with some drums, and I called them drum scratch. It's a scratch pad. And what I used here, it's not on this track anymore, but what I used here in the beginning was only a very simple drum with bass drum, kick, and some hi-hats. And as you can see here, these are the eighth notes. So this is the 1, 2, 3, 4, those lines. And you can see that these eighth notes are spaced not even, it's separately, because I used here, you can see up here, a swing function. I have here eighth note with a swing factor of 63. So we have that swing that's giving it a little push, because the second note is a little bit delayed. Let me just listen to this for a moment. Okay. F3, drum solo is here. Mix bus. This is working. Working again. Not working because it's muted. You can see I'm a big fan of the mute tool. You have that on 7 or that X here. You mute individual parts of the track. So if I open that in the editor again and I go to a straight eighth note quantizing here, that's here, down here, then you see that the grid is jumping and going here. So it's evenly spaced, the eighth note, but I have a grid of 63% swing. If you go here on edit, quantize panel, here you can set up your swing that is here, 63. And the more you turn it up, the more you can see here in the lines, the second eighth note is delayed or is coming later. So I have that long, short swing. That meaning first you have a long note and then you have a short. So I started with a simple pattern in one bar and started recording that. So it means I didn't know exactly what to do in the beginning with the intro. So I started with the verse, and here I started with some trumpet and sax and brass lines. And I started with what I call the brass kicks or the brass hits. This is this, you know that from all the big band playing when you hear this, like this. So here I used the brass from Halion Sonic, high brass section. And I used the second one to double that and make it it's real brass, made it a little bit more fat, and put one left and one right. I think so, it was one left, one right. Yes. Let's go here. And also did it here with longer notes. And I put this in a group. So I put a group here. So you can mark this, and then you can go to add track, add group track to selected channel. And I put it here to a kicks group. So it's both together in one sound. And then I have that New York kicks. This is a synth. Let me show you. This is something I copied from Mario, because I remember, I think he did that. He labeled one of his tracks New York. It's a parallel compression. That means I'm sending here, with the send, I'm sending here the signal to that New York kick channel. And here I have the vintage compressor. You have a parallel compression. Looks like this, and is mixed then to the original sound in parallel. And for all the brass that I have some stereo delay, so it's a little wider. And I also use for the group here reverb to put everything in one reverb. In this case, in this arrangement, I think I have only two reverbs, one for the vocals and one for the brass, and not more, because I wanted to have everything like in one room, like in one big band that is playing together. What I did then, after I put in the kicks here, I put in the bass, and the bass is an interesting part because here I used the chord function from Cubase. So let's just take this and copy it right here. Okay, so we can see that, like here, and track 87, that's okay. And if I go here and want to record here, and I go here on chords, and I activate the live input chords, then I can play on my keyboard the chords with only two or three notes from the C major chord. So in this case, when I record now the bass and I play only the C key, only the C, then this will follow the chord that is up here. So let me check that. Let me see. Okay, it's a little bit delayed because I have the latency up. So just let's record this. So, as you can see here, the notes are changing, but I was only playing the C, nothing else. So Cubase was doing that for me. And when I want to have the chord, if I play not the C, but the E, which is the third in the C major chord, it will play the third from the chord we have here, up here in the chord track. No matter if this is a minor or a major chord, it will be the right third. And if I play the fifth, then it will also play the fifth, which is the G. So in the next example, I'm going to play only the C and the G, and but the chords will follow and will play the proper root note and the proper fifth. You see, all I played was the C and the G. And because here I have the live input on chords, it will play the proper fifth and the proper root note of the chord in the bass. So this way I played the complete bass on the track here. So let's go back to the top and let's see that. This is the bass now. Let's go here. We can have the bass here. Okay. You see that it's changing, and here in this example I was only playing the C, the E, and the G from the G major chord, from the C major chord. And from the sound, there is nothing special in the sound here. I have only the bass, which is, let's go here, I cut a little bit the deep bass, put in some highs, and had a little bit compression from the tube compressor, and no effect here, and that's almost it. Let's see, what do we have here? That's the bass, I think that's coming from the Halion also, right? The dry finger bass, that's a normal bass from a big band bass. Okay, so after I recorded this, after I recorded the brass hits and the bass, I noticed that it's too much of the brass hits. And I listened to some tracks, like the one from Frank Sinatra and some other tracks, and noticed that there are also some horn or brass lines that are being played. So I erased everything. I erased complete brass again. I only kept the tracks here and put up another section. You can see here. You can see here a trumpet lines, saxes lines, trombones lines, and tuba. So it set it to like you normally have brass section. So the highest instrument is the trumpet. Then you have the sax, depending on what sax you use. Then you have the trombone, that is the one with where you will pull out and pull in, and a big bass tuba. And I use the sounds from the Halion, and you have to be careful. It depends on what you want to do with the brass and the horns. Do you want to write for real people playing that with their instruments? Then you have to have in account what notes can they play. For example, a trumpet cannot play very low. It has a certain range going very high. And a trumpet cannot play a high note in a low volume. It can only play a high note very loud. And so you have to take that into account. But if you want to make, like here, just an arrangement and you want to sound it to sound good, well, you just go with what you have. And in this case, in Cubase, the trumpet will also play, because Hellion is doing that, the low notes. But if I go here, I also have here the section, the brass section. I put that together and I double it with the brass here. Let's turn that off for a moment. And let's go to that part so you can hear all the four instruments, the horns, the sax, the trombones, and the tuba. So this sounds and plays in between the vocals. And to make it more fat, the whole thing, I use some brass again from Halion. Also the fanfare, it's called. Let's just check this, turn off the other ones. Like this. And put this fanfare into the arrangement. And this is playing then all the sounds and playing also all the notes. Because when you have individual instruments, you can play in a low octave, in a middle octave, in a high octave. That's what I did here. And also when you look at, where is my trumpet? There is the trumpet. It's called Saxline, but it's the trumpet. If I click here on the trumpets, it's in the three, going from F sharp 3 to C sharp 4. And if I go to the tuba, which is playing the bass, like here, I'm in the zero range of octave. So I'm very low down here. Okay, and altogether, it sounds, I have the section again. Would I put it on a subgroup? Sounds then like this. And here again, I used some parallel compressing. Let's go here. These are these ones, trumpet lines. No fancy things here, no big equalizer or something on the sounds itself. I just put them a little bit left and right. The trumpet to the left, the saxes to the right, trombone hard left, tuba hard right. And here we have the saxes solo, which are playing in the middle in the solo part. And this is sent then to the section here, section one, and which is sent to the reverb and also to the parallel compression, which is also again the vintage compressor of Cubase. Let's see if this. You see that it's compressed and then put as a parallel compression here to the original saxes. Yeah, and everything together, the whole arrangement or the whole section of the brass, we have the kicks. Let's go here. And it sounds then like this. And it's playing in between the text, in between the lyrics. So again, here I put everything in the same reverb, so it's in the same room. And I have some strings here. And here you can see that these strings are, the white ones here are muted. And that's what I do a lot. I just play along. Here I have some single lines playing in the normal verse where the singing is. And in that middle eight, I'm playing some chords. And I'm playing around with that. And most of the time, I put everything on every part of the song. But then later, I'm going to mute it just to see how it sounds without it. Maybe it's too much. And most of the time, I do that when I'm mixing. So that's just see what the strings are doing here. These are the normal strings, which are in the verse, at the end of the verse. And this is the middle eight. The one here. In the storm. But if you really hold me tight. Okay, this is in the whole part where the middle eight is the middle part. Okay. These are the main instruments, nothing fancy here. I could have taken more into that, like, for example, playing a piano on it, but I didn't have the time, so I had the deadline, so I had to decide what to do, so I went then for going for the drums, because the drums in the beginning were only one bar, repeated and repeated and repeated. And what I did here, you see, I have the drum scratch. I use that drum scratch for writing out or putting out the notes of the drums. And then afterwards, I just went here and selected this, went to MIDI, and then I went to dissolve parts to have then my drums on individual notes here. And what's this music is very famous for when you have the brass bands, when you have those brass hits or steps, the drummer is playing along with that. And that's what I put in later then. So let's go here to the first verse, like this. Let's go here. Yes. Where is this? Okay. And then you can hear when the brass are playing these hits that I will have also a crash and the snare going directly on the hit.
The weather outside is frightful, but the fire is so
Let's turn off that vocals for a moment. I have my vocals, everything on a subgroup here. Here, the vocals, where's the vocals stem? It's here. Let's mute that. So then we have this. Go back. What you see here? So you see that the snare, for example, is playing along with these hits here. Here, like this. This is solo. Go back. And also I put in some double bass. This is the original one I used here for putting in some double bass. Let me play this. Maybe it's easier when I play this and mute all that. So you see it easier. Okay. Like this. Mute that. Take mute of it. Doesn't matter. Go here. Don't know if you So this what you hear now is the unmixed sound. This is the unmixed sound of the drums. Let's go back and look here what I did to the drums. Let's go here. I think I don't have very much here from the kick and everything in the effects. I put it to the send. So I send everything to the reverb. I have EQ'd everything a little bit. Let's go here. This is the kick. Put in some highs in the kick, and I don't know what I did with the snare. Yes, also put in some highs, and sometimes I used a little bit compression. For the toms, I like to have the tom hits a little bit coming out on every tom. So that means if you look here on the EQ up here, I used one tom to find where the stick is hitting the tom and what's the prominent frequency of the stick here, and then put it in to all the toms. Let me just play that individually so you see, better you hear, what I did to the drums. Let's just go here, and do I have a drum group? I have a drum group, yes. So let's just listen to that. This is my drums group, here like this. Let's play here. So on the toms you hear, I have the same equalizer on all of the toms here. So it looks like this. This is the hit of the stick. And I put it on every equalizer here. Let me check here because it's always going to the back. It should be always on top here. Okay, if I'm always on top, it stays. And then you see that this is when I change. It's all in the same. I just copied over. This is the right, for example. I did nothing on the right. The crash, two crashes, the hi-hat. This is the snare. And this is the kick. So it sounded mixed. And then this is the one unmixed. So after I had all that and put in the drums, I had to come up with an idea for the intro, And in the beginning, I didn't know exactly what to do with the intro. So I started here in the intro with the brass, the horns. And I started by doing some, let's say, some horn runs, very fast ones, which sound, let's mute this here. Well, let's mute the drum group. And let's go to the beginning. So I put in these fast horn lines, and at the ending I put in some of the D minor 7 and A minor chord here. And after I recorded, for example, my vocals, I noticed that I have to shorten this chord because it went over to the vocals, to the words, and I had to correct some things because it was interfering with the words. And it was very important for me that some of the words, like in the middle eight, the word we kissed, that it was really good to hear for the listener and that not the instruments were playing them. So I used this one here and I put all in. That means I put all my brass sections and my individual like trumpet in to make the whole thing sound as fat as possible. Yeah. Oh, I had only the sections here. I don't have the individual here. The individual are here not playing, and I think the bass is also not playing. It's coming in later. And what I did here is then, if we go to the scratch, drum scratch, you can see here I put in some parts where I started in the beginning. This is here, for example, a fast, this is muted, this is a fast snare. You have here the snare, and here we have the tom run, and I think we have some, didn't put it here, put it in later. We have here some double bass. You have here and another hi-hat, like a count in, which sounds, if I play that along, let me unmute all this stuff here. Okay. Look, so you have it. So like this. And let's then just play the drums here. So that sounds very weird when you don't hear the drums, when you don't hear the brass with it. But when you listen to everything, then you hear that it's playing according to the brass.
Oh, there were the routes.
So that was the basic arrangement I had. So then the next thing was, you need some singing. You need some voice. And my idea was to sing it myself. And why you should sing it yourself, or why you should sing and produce your own vocals, is very easy because, first of all, it's fun. And you don't have to rely on somebody else singing for you. So it's very important as to have some basic ideas about that singing in mind. So I'm going to tell you now a little bit about how I approach the singing. What's the basic idea of my saying everybody can sing? And most of all, forget about, in the first place, about the microphone and the amplifier and the compressor and everything, because this is about the performance of the singing. It could have been better, I know. It took me about 30 minutes to sing everything. So what's my idea or my take on singing? You can see down here, these are my vocal tracks. And I put every part in and sang it several times, and then I combed it together, and I'm going back to this in a moment. When you never recorded your own vocal or your own voice, or never heard your own voice on a recording, like on a voicemail, answering machine, whatever, in the first moment it sounds very weird because you don't recognize your own voice. This is because you hear your own voice different than what the other people are hearing. When I'm talking or singing, when I'm talking, the sound is going from my mouth to the air, hitting the listener's ears and being processed in the ear, in the brain, and he can recognize my voice. When I talk and listen myself, I'm not only hearing the sound from my mouth, but I'm hearing all what I'm producing from my vocal cords
inside my head, and there are a lot of resonances that are ringing inside my head, are changing my voice. So your voice sounds maybe very different when you hear it on the recording than what you hear in your head, and you're not used to that. So when you first time hear your voice, it might be a little creepy. Oh, who is that guy? The first time I heard my voice, I was a little bit surprised because I thought I had a real lower voice. It was higher than I thought. And also the way I talk was sounding different. I think it's 30 years ago, I was like, who's that arrogant guy talking? And if you record your own voice for the first time, you have to have two hats on your head. You have to have two roles. First is you are the singer. You have to produce a good performance. But the other one, when you listen to your voice, is the producer. So you address your own recording like it's from a stranger. Don't care about that it's your own voice, if you like it or not. Simply think about, in technical terms, what you would say to a singer, how to change what he is singing or what he is doing. And as I always say, what's the important thing when singing? There are, I think, two different ways vocal teachers are addressing that. I looked up some videos about that. I talked to some vocal teachers. And I always say anybody can sing, because if you can produce a tune, a tone from your voice, you can sing. There are two things you have to have in account. Do I sing beautiful? That means, does my voice fit to the genre, to the song? Well, that can be addressed, or that can be totally wrong. If you have a rock voice and want to sing a ballad, it might be maybe not the right voice for the song. That's one thing. Do I sing beautiful? I'm not using the word do I sing good, because what is good is always a matter of how you address it. The second one is, do I sing the right notes? Do I hit the right notes? And this can be learned. If you watch these America's Got Talent or these talent shows, sometimes you see people who are totally off. So when they sing and you are too high with your voice, it's called you are sharp. And if you are too low with your voice, you're too low with your tone, with the pitch of your vocals, it's called you are flat. So, and some people are totally off. And this is because they don't hear it. So the important thing, some of the vocal teachers are saying that, is that you can hear. If you want to sing, you can hear. You have to hear. You have to hear if you sing right, if you sing the right pitch, and if you hit the right note. It's like playing a trumpet. On the trumpet, you have to do a lot with the pressure on the mouthpiece, and you have to hear if your tone you produce is the right pitch. So when you're working like me in 30 years in the studio, you had a lot of singers, and I know if somebody is flat or sharp, if you're singing the right note or a little bit too high, a little bit too low. So I know if I'm singing a little too high or too low, and I can correct it. So for me, the most important thing is that you hit the right note. Some other vocal teachers, I'm not a vocal teacher, but some vocal teachers might say the most important thing is that you breathe right, that you stand right. It all adds up to that. That's right, that you produce a full and good tone by the right technique and gesture. But if you produce the full tone and you don't hear that you have the wrong note, then it's not as good. So in my case, I will show you now how you can record your own voice and how, hello, YouTube background music. Good to see you back. I will show you how to record your own voice, why you should do that, because it's really fun, why I do that, and how can Cubase help you to record your own voice, your own vocals. The first thing I need is the melody here. I have the melody here in the notes I put in and have it as a piano, and I listen to the melody while I'm singing. So how can you record your voice? Let's see, here we have the test box here. That's one input here. That's one track I made. And here on this little icon, you can put in the lane. Now let's select this one. I don't know. I don't think that the microphone is working now. If I go to record here, like this, and let's solo this. Now we solo this, and it's recording over the part here. And if I cycle that, let me cycle that. Let's go back. If I cycle that, oops, Let's go to record. And now I can sing that part. And if I sing that part now, and it will go back, and I can cycle that, then it's going to record the next one, not over it, but make a new track, a new lane that you see here. And after you record it, everything will be here under the track. So that's what I did. I recorded my vocals. I think it was 5 takes. Let's stop this. Let's go off here. And what I'm going to do, what I'm going to show you now, is my original vocals I produced, I sang, and how it sounded and what I did to that. So I'm going here. This is from the first part. And after you record your vocal, the last lane will be active. Always the last lane will be active. And now what you can do is you can comb in your new vocal track. That means you select from all the recordings you have the best ones. And you have this hand tool up there, and it has two functions. The first function, make it a little bigger. The first function is to select the to arrange the parts, or to select what part to use. Like when I go here and hold my mouse and click here, I can go like this. And then I have here a full part like that. Or I can take this sentence, or I can take this sentence here, this part here, or I take the whole thing here up to here, and I have one complete performance. And then I can split it up like this and like this here. And then I can go through all the performances. I hold my mouse and I just drag over it, so I have the individual parts, the individual sentences, and then I just click once, and then I can go through all that. Now it's muted, so let's just go here and let's see if I can unmute all that stuff here. So you will hear data then. So let's see if it's doing what I want it to do. Like here, I can switch between that sentence. And so it sounds like this. Let me solo that, so you really hear what I did. Vocals, why is that not soloing? Let's go here, and here, and here. No, it's again on the wrong output, maybe stereo out, mix bus. Solo. Let's see if it's working. No, it's not working. Why is that not working? Wait a minute, I have to check that. I have to check that. Why is that not working? I'm going here. And I'm going here. Ah, I put up the vocal stem. Okay. Yeah, I have to put in this one again. I can see it. Okay, what you're going to hear now is really the original recording I made in the first place here.
Oh, the weather outside is frightful.
And I go to this one.
Oh, the weather outside is frightful.
And I select the next one.
Oh, the weather outside is frightful. But the fire is so delightful.
So I can switch here between all that. And then I can select which one is the best take and can put together these takes. So after I found the complete take here, I think I had some talking here in the beginning. I don't know what this was. Oh. This was just something left.
Oh, the weather outside is frightful, but the fire is so delightful. And since we've no place to go.
Okay. This one. Okay, why is the other one playing with it? Because I had that here on. That's, you heard all that. Let's go here. Mute the vocal group, so you only hear my original. Let's see. And if I go here. So now I need my group again. Where is that solo here? And mute this, okay. No, it's not going again. Why is it going?
Wait a minute, I have to check because I have it on the subgroup. Why is that not playing? Here, I have it soloed. This is vocals one. This is vocals one. Oh.
Since we've no place to go.
Here, I'll turn it down.
Let it.
I turned it down. That's why I'm not here. So what you hear now is really the original one. Here.
Oh, the weather outside is frightful.
And here you can jump around.
But the fire is so delightful. And since we've no place to go.
So you see that this is, for example, very, very flat and flattening here in the back.
Let it snow, let it snow, let it snow.
So after I have one version, what I do is then I color that. Let's go here. Then I just color that so I know what I used. And this is because I then want to make a double version. Let me go here. And what I do is just select this one. And then I go to either bounce elation or render in place. And my render setting in this case is that I'm not going to mute. You can separate here. You can here go to keep source events unchanged or mute source events. Normally you have it muted, so you have only the new track. But I don't do that here. I keep it like it is, and then I render it like this. So it will render now the complete part. Takes a moment. So you see down here that everything is rendered then. Then I have the individual parts here rendered that I selected. And see if I can play this then. So, okay. Let me solo this. Okay, if I solo this then you hear the complete part.
Weather outside is frightful. But the fire
this is the original
so
vocals
delightful.
I did. And you can do that too. What you need is you have to have the melody in your ear. Don't think you can do that if you do that for the first, second, or third time without practicing or without hearing the melody. You have to hear the melody. So what I do here then in the next part is I render the thing or I bounce it so I have one track here, everything, and replace it so I have a new track here. And you might notice that this is a stereo track because I forgot to put it in a mono track. I selected a stereo track when I made the new track, so I don't care. And the next thing I do then here is I'm going to my Cubase arranger, my editor, and go to edit Vari Audio. So now it's everything is analyzed. And what you can see, those lines here, these are my MIDI reference. I use here some MIDI input. Where is it here? Here is it. My select MIDI reference track. And there I selected the melody. So I see if I'm on the melody or if I'm too high or if I'm too low. So the first thing I do, I select everything like this. Just taking that around or pushing Control and A to select everything. And then I go to quantize pitch to 100%. And Cubase is going to shift the notes it detected to the next really full note. So, and without listening to it, I go through the individual notes like this. I select it here, and now I can arrow keys to go left and right. And here you see I'm too low. Cubase detected it wrong, or I'm too low. Maybe this is another version I didn't use. So what I do as the next step after going to 100% quantize pitch, I go to the part where playing the music and just put them in the right place like this. And also here you see that it's starting low and going high, so I put that start
right.
It's only a noise right. Put that up pull. And this here going up the end, I put that down,
but
the butt is to be here. And I go through all that.
Fire is so
light bulb.
So we are here now. So this is too high. Here this is too low. Here on the note. We go here on the note.
Go.
And here the ending is too high. Here the notes, maybe it's sung wrong or Cubist detected it wrong.
A little bit higher here.
And here you see the ending is always going, is also going up, so I'm putting that down. And then I put everything here. And
weather outside is frightful, but the fire is so delightful.
It's a little better because now the average note is on the note that is the melody. And now I'm going to address the individual parts. Just playing it together with the music. Let's see if I can do that here, like this. Playing it together with the music. Okay. Let's go here. Okay, be careful. These are the ones I don't need. Yep. And I don't need these. But I need that one. Okay. I mute all my original ones. Like this. I don't need them right now. No, I don't need them. Over here. Mute this. Okay, here in the end, I don't need to mute the end because I'm only playing the front. Then I have this, and then I have this one.
Weather outside is frightful, but the fire is so delightful. And since we've no place to go.
So this is the untreated vocals. The vocals after I corrected it to the next proper note. And now I'm going together with the music. Do not do that with the vocals alone. You need to have the music so you hear if you're right, if you're wrong.
Weather outside is frightful.
So the next thing is between optic, that means seeing, and hearing. So in this case, I can see right here, for example, that this is a little bit fluctuating like a vibrato. Here at the end, I'm going high, and I can show that quick. You can look that up in the manual or some videos. If you go here, you have different handles. All of the handles are you can turn them off or on. I turned all of them on. Here, for example, I can tilt the end, put it up or put it down like this. And here I can flatten it. That's like here, the straighten curve on this side. So I can straighten that here and also can tilt that down and straighten it again a little bit. And if it's too much, then I can go here, cut it into two parts, and correct this part again, and then straighten only the ending here. And also can, let me see if I can turn that up. No, I cannot turn that up. So
outside is fright.
So that was the volume. I had the volume up here. No, I had the volume up here. So I can go through all the parts. Like here, and doing only the major ones or the ones that I really find are a problem. I'm not going, I can be really picky here, and you can really make a big arrangement out of that and changing every note. Like when you see this one here, oops, not like that. When you see this one here, select this one, and let's go, let's look at this, and let's listen to this.
Fire is so delight.
So it's going down, going up here. So in this way, I would cut it here and would cut it here. So I have three parts.
I put this part here,
and
also
like this. So this is straight almost. Then I would straighten that a little bit and straighten that a little bit. Oh, that was wrong. Like this, and then.
The fire is so delightful.
So my problem when singing is, and you can see that in some parts here, like this one here, is that I have some change. I'm going up and down with a pitch, but not like a controlled vibrato. And so the problem is, if it's not controlled and I have a doubled voice, I have a second voice,
It will have also that going up and down in pitch. And if you put them both together, you will have like two detuned oscillators in a synthesizer. You have will have that phasing effect. And so I was first thinking about putting everything here, make everything straight, but it will sound artificial. So if I would have taken more time, not only 30 minutes to sing everything, but maybe an hour or practice a little bit, then it would be better. But you can see here, this is a little bit, and also here, I didn't use this one.
Since we have no place to go.
See here that go is totally fluctuating, and when I go to straighten the curve here, it would be a little bit better.
Since we have no place to go.
But you still hear it, so you have to be careful with that, but you should experiment with that. And to do so, it's the best if you use your own voice. Because if you're not used to singing and not such a good singer like me, then if you have a perfect singer, you don't have to do that. So if you want to practice that skill, so use your own voice and do that. You see my performance here is very bad. I'm going here fluctuating and starting here very flat, going high at the end and everything. I don't think that I use this. So I put together my vocals here and put together a track and put together a second track from the same one. That's why I use the color tool to color these red, because if you put one track on the left and one track on the right, then you have the double effect, like with a delay and everything. But if one part is the same part, it will fall back in the middle, like in mono. So you will not have a doubling. So what I did here, I experimented a little bit because I didn't like it too much what I did here. So let's just listen to this part, the first part I did. And here you see the white one is muted again from the mute tool, my favorite tool. So let's unmute that and let's look at that. You can see here, this one is in the middle. Here, let's go here. Where are we? Here we are. Here we are. And we have the reverb here. This one is in the middle and the second one is also in the middle. So if I play them both together, let's see how that sounds.
Oh, the weather outside is frightful.
Ah, the other one is playing again here. I have to mute. Is that playing? No, it's not playing. This one is playing. This one is playing. Like this.
Oh, the weather outside is frightful, but the fire is so delightful.
So this is bubbled now because I put two tracks together. And they're both in the middle. You can also put them to the side. Put this one to left up here and this one to right. And if there's too much fluctuation between the pitches, then you have that phasing effect. And I didn't want that.
Oh, the weather outside is frightful.
Oh, this is left and right.
But the fire is so delightful.
So in this case, I went for something different. I took the first voice, put it in the middle here. And the middle here. Okay. See, in the middle, and I muted this one, and from the effects, let's go here, let's go to vocal one. You can see I have a vocal reverb here.
And since we've no place to go.
And I'm using my standard, I'm using an 1176 style compressor, a fast compressor, the vintage compressor, with a fast attack and a fast release. To address the spikes.
Let it snow, and let it snow.
Only 1 to 5 dB of gain reduction. Then I'm going to the tube compressor to even it out a little more.
Oh, delightful. And since we've no place
here,
to go.
And then I'm using the frequency here. Let's go here. Because I have a little problem. If I'm not singing properly, I'm singing too much to the nose and my voice then sounds a little bit nasal. That's why I had to address some frequencies here to get rid of the sound, because when I double then and put some extra tracks in, everything adds up and it's too nasally, the whole voice. Because in this case, as said before, I'm taking only 30 minutes to sing the whole thing through 5-6 times each part and didn't care too much. I didn't practice. So it wasn't that good from the sound. And I'm sending it then to the vocal reverb. And this is the equalizer. Let's see the equalizer here. It's just also again getting rid of a little bit mud here and putting some highs and vocal reverb. And that's the most thing I did for the main vocal. And then I used the second track I had. And here in this, I put it in the center again. In this case, I doubled it electronically by using here the stereo delay. And most of you might have seen me doing that before. You know that trick, what's called the Haas effect, when you have the original on one side and you have a delay on the other side. Most people are doing the original on the left side and the delay on the right side. Because we're so used to it, I'm doing it the other way around. So I'm taking this delay 2 here, put the feedback to 0, put the mix on tries, so, and on the right side. So the original vocal is on the right side and the left side is delayed by 22 milliseconds, no feedback, all wet. So you have a delay on one side and you have the original on the other side. Let's go here.
Oh, let it snow, let it.
So you can hear that it's double left and right. Is it playing? Okay, but it's coming in on the second part only.
And since we've no place to go, let it snow, let it snow, let it.
So I doubled this with the original track, the original first track in the middle. So at the second part, I'm starting with the original in the middle, then the second part, the doubled one.
Oh,
kicks in.
Delightful. And since we've no place to go.
And then I took my original one and went to audio and generate harmony voices. And this will generate 4-part harmony voices. And also depending on the chords you have here. That's why I have the chord track running up here all the time. You have 4 harmonies. You have bass, tenor, alto, and soprano. But because my voice is very low, the high voices didn't sound so good, so I didn't use them. I used that generated voices for the tenor and the vocals and the bass here at the end. And I put them hard left and hard right. You have it here, left and right. And since they are generated by the original voice, they are perfectly in sync with the original voice. And I don't want that. I want to have it a little bit different. So I'm delaying that a little bit. And that delay means I'm using the track delay. So if you go here on the left side in Inspector, you see here the track delay in milliseconds. So that means if you put a negative value in, you shift it forward. That means the track starts earlier. And if you put a positive value in, the track starts later. So this track, the tenor, is starting 22 milliseconds before the other track, and the bass is starting 22 milliseconds after the other track. So let's just play the original one plus the tenor and the bass.
Let it snow, let it snow, let it snow.
So since this is left and right, hard left and hard right, and delayed, you can also hear that it's separated from each other. Let's play those artificial ones again.
Let it snow, let it snow, let it snow.
So you hear how artificial this is. So this is only something to put in very, very lightly. But sometimes it sounds good. And sometimes I'm going to use that. I'm going to generate these voices and then sing it. Because then I know, if I go here, then I know what notes I have to sing. Here, this is staying on the root note of the track, of the chord. You see here, the root note of the chord. I don't know if I can do that here. No, I cannot do that here. Just let me check here if I can put in the other track. No, I cannot do that here. I thought I can do that here. So I see the chords in the MIDI. I can, when I go to a MIDI editor like here, I can hear up here, you see the chords, because you can then select which global tracks you want to see. This is the marker track and the chord track. So when you, for example, are here in let's go to the brass again, and you have the chords up here, the chord track should be up here. Don't see that. Oh, it's here. I have no chord here. See the chord at the beginning, you see here the chord, then you can see if your chord fits to what you played, but not in audio. So in this case, you see that it's using mostly the root note of the chord. And then, for example, you can use it if you have no idea to double it to make harmonies. Just let Cubase do the thing, don't use it, and just sing it. So the whole thing then alone sounds like this.
Oh, the weather outside is frightful, but the fire is so delightful. And since we've no place to go, let it snow, let it snow, let it snow.
So this was the first part, then I went on for the second part, which is here. It's the same again. Second part is like this.
A weather outside doesn't show signs of stopping. And I
had some problems with my voice here, but I didn't correct
ping.
It. And again,
the lights are turned way down low.
And with the harmonies.
Let it snow, let it snow, let it snow.
And then we have that middle eight part. I call it the middle eight, which is the different one here. Sounds like this.
Oh, the fire is slow.
Oh, and the middle eight is before here. This.
When we finally kiss goodnight,
like you're saying,
how I hate going out in the storm.
So I put everything in here. And I put everything then, all the tracks going to a vocal subgroup, have a vocal reverb, a stereo doppler and some ping pong effect. And I used just a little delay to make the vocals a little bit wider. And I used an extra reverb for that, and I use also a parallel compression, but I think I didn't use that because it was too much here. Cannot say exactly what I did here, only a little bit of the New York vocals. That's the parallel compression and the reverb here. And if I go then and show you something else, what I did some automation then, and I'm not so picky with that, with the automation. I'm going more for the manual, not from with the controller and everything here. For example, when I go here, let's look at this. The automation I'm using here, for example, for the trumpet line. Or let me show you if I would do automate here the success solo, then I would turn on the volume here for the automation lane. And if I say this part is not loud enough, or I have another part that should be louder, then I take the range tool. Then I select it like this, and then I just put it up or down the way I need it. So this is very easy. I'm not going too much with my controller here and putting the things up and down. And I'm very fast with that, because here you can see, for example, with the sax lines here, I turned the things up in the solo, but I turned down the trumpet here in the solo just by using the range tool, and then like this. And then going here and putting that up and down. So there's several ways you can work with that. You can copy it to another track and have a fixed volume with your fader, like copying and having a fixed volume. And like in this case, I put all my vocal tracks on individual tracks. And this is mostly to have some separation and to see where the individual parts are. You can put also these, for example, the main vocal on one track, but then if you need different volumes or a different sound, for example, then you have to automate it or change something. So let's look at the clock. It's now 8:00. We are almost there. Let's look at my list. I was talking about working with lead sheets and with the chord track and about the arrangement. Let's see if I have everything on the arrangement here. I think I have. Let's see here. I was talking about the vocals, how I set the vocals, and I was playing to you the original vocal, how it was when I sang it. And again, don't be afraid of your own voice. Record your own voice. Start to sing. It's fun. And also, you can learn it. I also learned it. And for me, the important part about singing is that you can hear, or that you hear and learn to hear, if you're singing the right pitch, the right note, if you're too high or too low. For example, here I had my melody up here, and then I discovered that I'm singing one octave lower, so I used the second melody here that was one octave lower, and that was running while I was in my headphone very loud while I was singing. And what you can do to practice is you just sing your vocals, and then you go and here, look at this. You go on the left side, you have the reference track where you
You can select a reference track where your MIDI is. If I select no MIDI reference track, it's gone. See, this is now edit where I have no MIDI reference. If I go to, now it's saving, if I go to select and I select this one, okay, this is too high. See, this is the higher melody. Now I go one octave lower. Then I see if I'm on the pitch. And then you can practice with that. And then you also discover if you have some problems with a vibrato or not. And you can learn all that. There are some interesting books about that. Oh, I forgot to put them here. One book I'm using a lot is Singing for Dummies, from the Dummies series, Singing for Dummies. And the other one is the Rock and Roll Singer Survival Guide, which is more for rock music. No, it's not here. It's lying around here. Rock and Roll Singer Survival Guide. And all of those books tell you, you don't read those books from beginning to end. You just pick the parts that are interesting for you. For example, for me, what I have to work on is my breathing so that I have a steady tone and I get a controlled vibrato, because I see here, then I can find the right pitch, because I hear if I'm wrong, and if I do it two or three or four times with a melody, I know if I have to sing higher or lower. And now I know what to concentrate on the proper breathing and on having the pitch constant, and also having a controlled vibrato. Okay, so that's about it. We talked about the horn parts. We talked about the singing. Don't be afraid, as I said before, about your own voice, because when I started with doing things like that, it was about 4 years ago, another Christmas song for a contest. I didn't like my singing too much. It wasn't good. So I went for that artificial T-Bane auto-tune sound. You can also do that. You just go here, just select everything, then you go straight and curve, totally flat. And let's see here how that sounds.
Frightful, but the fire is so delightful.
Now you hear that.
And since we've no place to go.
Has a little bit of that T-Bane effect. And then when you say shift the formants here, you shift also the tone of the voice.
The weather outside is frightful,
but the fire is so delightful.
So you can make your voice artificial. You don't need a singer. No matter what music you make, if you want to have some tracks, you can do that. I can read here from YouTube background music, vocal chop making, marshmallow. Well, vocal chop making is something you can do with a sampler track. Like when you go here, go in the sampler track and put that here. Let it go. Yes, it did. And then chopping everything up. That will be something I can do in one of the next videos. Good idea. I write that down. How you chop that up and how you can play different notes and different parts here in the sampler, and how you can chop everything up and make these modern, more artificial vocal sounds you have for singing, say in electronic music. Let's call it electronic music in total. Okay, that's it for today. Thanks for watching. Thanks for tuning in. Really appreciate that. I'm going to be live again next year. I hope you had a good year. I hope for every one of us the next year will be better. It's even good with this corona time. We have a better year next year. I hope you liked what I showed you today about the arrangement, about using the drums, and most of all, what I wanted to address today is the part with the singing. Sing your own vocals, because that makes you different from all the others. You can find a singer, okay? And even if you only write music or make beats for rappers and you don't know how to rap, at least you can use some background vocals you sing yourself, and that will separate you from the others, because this is your music, this is your instrument, and nobody else will have that. So I wish you a good time tomorrow when there's New Year's Eve, when we're going over to 2021. And let's see, maybe I'm going to play this again for you. If you have any more questions, simply put it in the chat. I'm staying here for another, say, 5 minutes. And I'm playing this again for you and wish you all the best. And I see you next time. with a live stream, and maybe one of the subscribers ask for something like lo-fi pop and send me a YouTube video. So if you, for example, have a song or a YouTube video and you want to know how is this working, how do they come up with that sound or whatever, simply send me a comment, point me to the YouTube video. In that case, I'm going to recreate that lo-fi sound for him, and I'm going to play that in another live stream next year. So, yes, Zarko, the same to you. Good sleep to you, and have a good time tomorrow when we're going over to 2021. And see you next time. Good.
Oh, the weather outside is frightful, but the fire is so delightful. And since we've no place to go, let it snow, let it snow, let it snow. It doesn't show signs of stopping, and I bought some corn for popping. The lights are turned way down low. Let it snow, let it snow, let it snow. When we finally kiss goodnight, how I hate going out in the storm. But if you really hold me tight, all the way home I'll be warm. Oh, the fire is slowly dying, and my dear, we're still goodbye. And as long as you love me so, let it snow, let it snow, let it snow. When we finally kiss goodnight, how I hate going out in the storm. But if you really hold me tight, all the way home I'll be warm. Oh, the fire is slowly dying, and my dear, we're still goodbye. And as long as you love me so, let it snow, let it snow, let it snow. Let it snow, let it snow, let it snow. Let it snow, let it snow, let it snow.